begin this morning by calling your remembrance to something that most of you have probably seen happen at least sometime during the course of your lives. Have you ever seen somebody struggle with a vending machine? Yeah, you have. That's why. Yeah, I was thinking about you, Curtis, because I thought if there's anybody who knows about this, it's probably you from what you've seen people struggle with and when you've had to struggle with them, too. And my mind just started imagining different scenarios where people have put money into a vending machine. And when they do it, you know the drill. They're expecting, okay, I put my money in, I put quarters or dollars, however much it told me, and I press the button, and out is supposed to come whatever I pressed. And when it does not happen, then their usual options are pretty funny if you happen to see this happening to somebody. If you're conscientious of people being around, then you're probably going to be cool, calm, and collected about it. You're not going to be one of these three examples. You might just be like, oh man, what happened? And you just, oh, no problem, you'll walk away. But you might be one of the three people that does one of these three things. Somebody who just begins to rock the machine, right? Maybe you've been that person. Just start to push it. You don't want to be too obvious. Maybe you'll just be cool, calm, and collected. A little push, right? A little push. If nobody's around, maybe it'll be more of a shake. That's option number two. There's the person who doesn't just rock the machine. They're like hugging the machine. And it just looks kind of funny because they're like, you know, the machine's bigger than them, most people, and they're just rocking it back and forth. And then you got the person who just tries to stick their arm up the bottom of the machine, thinking they could reach whatever's there. Maybe it's a bag of chips, and they just see it, and they're hoping they could get it. But you just know they're struggling. And the reason why they're struggling, very logical, because they put money into the machine, and they press the button, they did what they were supposed to do, and they're expecting something to come out. And when it does not come out, if nobody's around, they're going to town on the machine. Now, hopefully that image will be in your mind when it comes to prayer, because too often, even if we suppress that feeling, it's kind of what we often want to do in prayer, because we just expect, hey, I showed up. You said ask anything in my name. I did. I did. I asked it, and I made sure when I finished the prayer, I made sure I said, in Jesus' name. And you said, anything that you ask in my name, I'm going to do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. I'm asking, and it isn't happening, so I'm going to start shaking the machine now. It's not going to look like that, obviously, but in my heart, there's a turmoil. There's turbulence that's happening because I went through the motions that I thought I was supposed to go through. I came boldly to your throne of grace. I came to you. I asked, and when that didn't happen, I sought, and I knocked all the more, and when that didn't happen, I just don't understand why this is not happening. And then all of a sudden there's a little bit of turmoil in the soul, and granted it may not look as overt as the guy or the gal who starts to rock the vending machine, but it's emblematic of how often we feel in prayer because we don't understand this petition that we're going to look at this morning. Most fundamentally, that struggle that we have, this vending machine-like mentality that we have with God in prayer, is because we don't truly understand the preeminence, note that word, preeminence of saying, believing, and wanting your will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. God cares about our needs. He cares about our wants. We see that in the rest of the prayer. Hence the emphasis on the word preeminence, the preeminent value and prominence of saying, not my will, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So hopefully for any of us who have vending machine-like mentalities when it comes to God, that's already beginning to change. And I pray that it won't only change, but God the Holy Spirit will come with strength this morning to help you in that waiting. Because as we're going to see, saying that is a lot easier than feeling okay with that oftentimes. But we'll get there soon. By way of review, I want you to remember that this is the fourth week that we're giving consideration to the subject of prayer. It's the third week that we're giving consideration to the subject of the Lord's Prayer, or perhaps better stated, the disciples' prayer. We started with a message called Why Pray? It was a one-week break from the Gospel of Luke study that we've been doing. And I do encourage you, if you have not heard that, we touch upon a lot of different prayer issues there. It was a great primer to lead into this study. From that, we ended up going back into the Gospel of Luke, and we began with considering this great address that Jesus gave us to address our Heavenly Father with. And it's just that, Father. We come and we get to call God Father. We are not Jedi Masters trying to deal with an impersonal force. and trying to navigate and manipulate the force. We're not doing that. We're coming to Father, our Father who is in heaven, a personal, loving Father who paid the highest price for adoption. He paid the price of offering up his son. And if you remember, we talked about how exorbitant adoption fees can be in our culture, but as high as they could get or ever get this side of eternity, whatever we would imagine that to be, it doesn't come close to the adoption fee that the Father paid to adopt us into his family. And the beauty of our relationship with God is that we are both adopted and we are given new birth. So we kind of have both going on. We're new creations spiritually because we received new birth from above, but yet we're also adopted into his family. Beautiful pictures to make sure we don't miss the point. I am your Father. Come to me and address me as Father and see the glory of that. And for those of you who enjoyed that study and you kind of in your heart maybe say, I wish we could go back to that and talk more about that, we're going to have an opportunity to, because Jesus is going to talk more about the character of a father in Luke's gospel, particularly verses 11 through 13. So we're not done doing what John told us to do in 1 John chapter 3, verse 1, beholding what manner of love this is, that we would be called children of God. Then we made our way to the second petition of the Lord's Prayer, hallowed be your name. So when we got there, we saw that when we are praying for that to happen, we are praying that God's name, meaning the sum of all his attributes and the totality of who he is, would be hallowed or regarded as holy. We gave a few examples of what that would look like using other places in the scripture in the New King James Version where that word hallow is used. It will look like God's word being believed. It will look like God's word being obeyed. And it will look like God being reverentially feared. So when you're praying that, that's part of what you're praying. Then last week, we came to the petition, your kingdom come. And we saw that there were three things that we were in essence praying for. And you could probably expound upon it more, but we honed in on three things. When we pray, Father, let your kingdom come, what we are praying for is that the kingdom of Satan might be destroyed, that the kingdom of grace might be advanced by salvation and by sanctification, and that the consummation of the kingdom of glory may be hastened. So when you pray, your kingdom come, that's what you're praying. That brings us to this morning, where we come to the third petition of the Lord's Prayer, where we read, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, before we dive into this petition, you may notice something in your New King James Bibles. You may notice a footnote that says, NU omits the rest of verse 2. Now, what that is saying this. In some of the earliest manuscripts that we have in Luke's Gospel, this part of the verse is not found in the NU, that old selection, the oldest selection of manuscripts. It's found in the majority text, some of the later text, not found in the earliest ones. So the New King James Scriptures is letting you know, okay, this is the difference here. In some of the earlier manuscripts that we have, the part that says, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, isn't there. But in later manuscripts it is. So we're going to give attention to it this morning because whether or not it was in Luke's original writing, it was in Matthew's. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. This was part of the way Jesus taught his disciples to pray. We've already noted differences. Matthew is a more comprehensive teaching on the Lord's Prayer, and Jesus told his disciples, when you pray, pray in this manner. So this is a format, this is a structure for you to pray, and it's more comprehensive. In Luke's gospel, we see Jesus said, when you pray, say. So again, I'm going to say this so we have it burned in our minds. Which one is it? Do we say the prayer or do we use it as kind of a structure for prayer? And I say both. You could do both. Both is fine as long as you're praying it really from your heart. But Luke's prayer is a more synopsisized version. Matthew's prayer came earlier in Jesus' ministry when Jesus was teaching on the Sermon of the Mount in Galilee. This time when Jesus is teaching his disciples, it's at a later time. So it makes sense that it wouldn't be verbatim because Jesus isn't locking them into a way to pray lock and step. Remember, the disciple in Luke chapter 11, verse 1, asked Jesus, teach us how to pray, as John also taught his disciples. He did not say, teach us a prayer. So it would make sense that they're not identical with one another. But we do draw our attention to this petition this morning. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. This petition implicitly answers three questions. It's going to kind of be the format through which we're going to dive into that text this morning. It's answering the question, what, where, and how. So you'll see that as we go through it this morning. First thing that we want to notice is, what are we praying for? It may seem obvious, but let's say it again. We're praying that God's will would be done. That's what we're praying for. Now, when you use the term God's will, and when the Bible uses the term of God's will or uses words that talk about God's will, it's not always talking about the exact same thing. There's a secret will of God, a secret will that He has chosen not to reveal to people. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 29 says, "The secret things belong to the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law." So there are things that we do not know. There are things that God has chosen to do, and we don't know why He has done them. There are things that God has in His mind that He has purposed to say, you know what, these are secret, these are for me, and the revealed things are for you and your children forever. So when we talk about God's will, let's understand there's a secret will of God, meaning not like a secret like, oh, let's go find it out. Oh, who's got that spiritual gift of finding out the secret will of God? No, 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 that's dangerous. That's how cults and heresies start. People think they find out the secret will of God. We're talking about a will that God has chosen not to reveal. Second will of God, when we're talking about the will of God, is the providential will of God. This is the will of God that's made known and manifested in time. The Apostle Paul speaks about this when he's praying for the church of Rome, or talking to the church at Rome about praying for them. And he says that he makes request for them with joy. But then he says this in verse 10, chapter 1, verse 10 of Romans. He says, "Making request if, by some means, now at last, I may find a way in the will of God to come to you." So he was hoping that the providential will of God was going to be that he could visit the church in Rome. He didn't know. Making request, if by some means in the will of God, I may come to you. Well, he was going to find out the will of God. He was going to find out whether or not it was his will to get to Rome by whether or not he got to Rome. So there's a secret will of God that only God knows. There's the providential will of God, what God makes known throughout history. All history, you could say, is the providential will of God. It's how He has ordered the events of history, and we get to look at it. Interpreting all the events of history, different story. But viewing it, you can view His providential will in that way. And then the third thing we could say about God's will is there's the clearly revealed will of God. The revealed will of God is everything you find in sacred Scripture. Sacred Scripture reveals to us the way of salvation. There is no other name under heaven given to men whereby they must be saved. Acts chapter 4, verse 12. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by Him. It is by grace that you are saved, through faith. It's a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no man can boast. This is the revealed will of God. Jesus said, if you believe that I am He, you won't die in your sins. And if you don't believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. Jesus said, he who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son will not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. This is the revealed will of God. Every command in Scripture is the revealed will of God. God has revealed a lot to us. So when we talk about the will of God, that's what we're talking about in broad terms. But when we're praying, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, what specifically then are we praying for? When we pray, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, we are basically praying for two things. And again, you can unpack it further, but I want to emphasize two things. We are praying a prayer of submission, where we are saying, implicitly, I want your will to be done, and I'm submitting to that will. So it's a prayer of submission, and it's saying, I want what you want to be manifested on this earth to be manifested. So what you're praying for is you're praying for God's desires to come about. You're praying for God's purposes and intentions to happen, but implicitly, while you're praying that, it's a prayer of submission, but it's not only a prayer of submission. It's not only passive, it's active. But first I want to hone in on that part of the prayer. You're praying for God's will to come about, His purposes. It's connected to His kingdom too. You can look at that in the prayer and the structure of the prayer. Because if God's kingdom comes, in a person's life, or ultimately in the consummation of history, what's going to happen? His will is going to be done. When a person gets saved, all of a sudden the kingdom comes in their heart and in their life, and then what happens? The will of God is done in their heart and in their life. Not perfectly, but you might say increasingly. When Jesus establishes his reign on this planet, the will of God will be done. The kingdom will come and the will of God will be done. And in the consummation of history, in the eternal state, his will be done perfectly. So when we're praying for that. But I want to hone in right now on the prayer of submission that it is. And I hone in on this because I think, in my thinking about this verse, I think one of the things that is so difficult for Christians is praying this prayer, particularly when they have made prior choices to obey God and are now in situations where things are hard. I thought about it, and I thought about just the irony of that. It's kind of that vending machine mentality that some of us don't even want to have, but we kind of do have. You know this. If you ever made a decision for God, you couldn't stay at that job because that job was just not right, and they were asking you to do unethical things, and you're like, you know what? I'm leaving that place of business. Lord, I know you want me to, because this is pretty clear. This isn't like gray. This is pretty clear. They're doing things they shouldn't be doing. Okay, you know what? I can't stay here. I'm leaving. And all of a sudden you go, I'm going to the Lord in prayer for another job. And you find yourself waiting for 6 months, for a year for a job, for 2 years. And you're like, what's happening? Like, I did this because that's clearly your revealed will, and now I'm praying and it's just not happening? You think about a person who leaves a relationship with somebody, maybe a woman who leaves a man or a man who leaves a woman, because they said, you know what? You don't love Jesus. And I'm going to just trust Jesus that he's going to bring somebody into my life that does love him, so I can't be with you. I just can't be with you, and I'm just going to trust God. And all of a sudden this person makes that decision based upon a clear precept of God's scripture, and all of a sudden now they're waiting. And they're waiting a year or 2 years or 3 years, and they're wondering if God is ever going to come through with that spouse. When they made that prior decision for God, do you feel the pain of this kind of situation? It's not a light thing. Any of you who have ever been in a situation like that, or any of you who are in situations like that, when you're wondering, what are you doing, God? Like, I love you. You're awesome. You're amazing. You're my Father. But I made this decision for you, and now I'm in a place where I'm waiting for your will to be done, and I'm wanting your will to be done, but it just seems like you're just not answering my prayer. I think that's often the most difficult place for people to pray, for Christians to pray, your will be done, because it's just confusing. Like, I made a prior decision, and I thought you were going to do something at least sooner. Now, the first thing I want to address, and you can address this, I'll address it in my own heart. And I got to check my own heart and say, George, do you have a vending machine-like mentality when you're doing that? Like, do you think that you put in an act of obedience, therefore you're pressing the button of prayer for a certain thing, and George, maybe it's not God's will for that thing to happen right now. But maybe you just expect it because you think you kind of deserve it. You think that you put kind of prayer change in your prayer piggy bank and now you want to collect? And it's hard. But I want to give you some encouragement. And I didn't pull this out of nowhere. I'm saying this because one of the clearest examples we have in Scripture is Jesus. When Jesus had to pray, not my will, but your will be done. And it was by no means easy. In the Garden of Gethsemane, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, in Luke chapter 22, verses 41 through 44, you can read the account I'm going to make reference of right now. Jesus is praying, and he's praying to the point we see that he is sweating, and drops of blood are mingled with his sweat, even after he prays what I'm going to tell you that he prays. You remember Jesus had to drink that cup that was alluded to quite a few times in the Old Testament, that cup of God's wrath. And Jesus, who was perfectly God and perfectly man, he did not want to drink the cup that the Father was giving him to drink. He who knew no sin was about to be made sin on our behalf so that we could become the righteousness of God. Great, glorious, good news for us. Bad news that we can't even imagine for Jesus. So he's in the garden and he's praying to his Father and he says, Father, if there's any other way, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. It wasn't easy in that moment for Jesus to pray that. So the first point I want to make is when you're praying, your will be done, It's not always going to be easy. We don't always say, "Your will be done," with smiles. We don't always say, "Your will be done," with fruit of joy bursting out of the seams. We sometimes pray, "Your will be done," in the most painful, tenaciously painful moments of life. This was so amazingly painful for Jesus. Like I said, he's sweating drops of blood. And the condition of that even happening talks about the angst and the anxiety, not sinful anxiety, inappropriate anxiety, of being crushed by his Father on the cross. So praying, "Your will be done, not my will," is not always easy. That's the first thing. Let me just say that. It could sometimes be very hard. So if you are in a season of waiting and you want that cup to pass, so to speak, it's not Jesus' cup. It's going to be a little cup. He had the big cup of wrath. You may have a little cup of circumstances. And I'm not diminishing that, but I am diminishing it in light of Jesus' cup of God's wrath. And you and I may have small cups of circumstances to drink, and we're praying, "Oh Lord, just please move this cup, please." But if you're not going to do it, that's fine. Not my will, but your will be done. And you may say that with pain in your heart when you do. And if you do, you fall in line with Jesus, because Jesus had to do that as well. But there are two amazing encouragements in that text, and that arise from what happens after that text, that I want to draw your attention to just briefly. Jesus in this moment is praying, "Not my will, but your will be done," to his Father. And if that did happen, if the Father did give an affirmative answer to that prayer, Jesus would have never seen many sons come to glory. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. He would never have seen the travail of his soul and been satisfied. Isaiah 53, verse 11. He would never have been able to stand up in the midst of the assembly and call his people, whom he has redeemed, brethren. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 11. He would have never gotten to the joy that was set before him on the other side of the cross, of which he despised the shame. He would not have gotten there. So the fact that the Father said no to that prayer was for Jesus' ultimate good, yet alone us. But in that moment, the pain of that impending judgment was dominant. And when you're in a season when you don't understand why your small cup isn't passing, and you have to pray, "Not my will, but your will be done," you will be well served to think about the joy that's on the other side of that little cross. You have to be confident that there is. There is. God is not wasting our waiting. God is not wasting our trials. He's using everything together for our good and for his glory. But the second thing I want to draw our attention to is in that very text, when Jesus prays, he ends up praying again after he prays that. And when he prays that first time, we're told that an angel came and strengthened him. Now, did the angel bring the answer too? Did the angel come and say, "No, the cup's not passing"? I wouldn't go so far to say that, because the text does not say that, and Jesus kept praying afterwards as well, so I'm not going to go there. But I will say this: the text clearly says the angel came and strengthened Jesus. So one of the things that may happen when you're praying, "Not my will, but your will be done," when you're submitting to the will of God, maybe God's dispatching angels to strengthen you. It's not loony, it's biblical. They're ministering spirits sent to those who will inherit salvation. And if an angel could come and strengthen Jesus after his temptation in the wilderness, and if an angel can come and strengthen Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, God could use angels to strengthen you. God can use his Holy Spirit, of course. That's the predominant means that he's going to use, his Word and his Spirit. But I just want to affirm the reality of, you may get an answer to the prayer, and it may be no, but maybe in the no, God provides you with strength in that immediate moment to help you with the no. I love that picture. Imagine one of us just in prayer, breaking down before God because of the little cup that we have to bear. And then God is saying, "No, I'm not changing the circumstance. It is staying just the way it is. But I am going to answer your prayer in a way that you didn't ask. I'm sending strength right now via the wind of my spirit, via a brother or sister calling you up on the phone, via an angel coming to quicken you." I do want to say this, when we do pray like this, I want to say one more thing about that. When we pray, "Your will be done," in a submissive posture, we look like Jesus and not like Jonah. If you read the story of Jonah, we did, I think, 5 messages, maybe 6, on Jonah a few years ago here. And you see, Jonah was not happy with the will of God. It was God's will being done, but for Jonah, it wasn't just difficulty. See, Jesus experienced the difficulty of God's will. Jesus did not complain against the will of God. Jonah, however, ends the book of Jonah with telling God, "It is right for me to be angry at you." And then God ends the book of Jonah with a question. But Jonah had the will of God come right before him, and God was not changing his plans. He was bringing mercy to Nineveh, and Jonah said, "You know what? Your will is done, and I'm angry, and it's right for me to be angry." Don't be like Jonah. If that little cup is not going to pass from you, don't be like Jonah. Don't be angry at God or people. Don't be bitter. Be like Jesus. Jesus, in this moment, he feels the difficulty, but he trusts his Father. You see that in Hebrews chapter 5. He offered up prayers with loud cries and supplications and tears to his Father, and he committed his soul righteously to his Father, according to 1 Peter chapter 3. He committed his soul to him who judges righteously. So when you submit to the will of God, and when you pray your will be done in an act of submission, with trust instead of anger, you look like Jesus. J.C. Ryle says, "Submission of will like this is one of the brightest graces which can adorn the Christian character. It is one which a child of God ought to aim at in everything, if he desires to be like Christ. But at no time is such submission of will so needful as in the day of sorrow, and in nothing does it shine so brightly as in a believer's prayers for relief. He who can say from his heart when a bitter cup is before him, 'Not my will, but yours be done,' has reached a high position in the school of God." So the first element I want to talk about concerning this petition is it is a prayer of submission. You're submitting your will to the will of God because you know it's best. You trust him, even if it's very hard. But now I want to make an important point, because I think many of us, when we hear the prayer, "Your will be done," we only think of it as being passive. Like, many Christians won't even want to pray that in a prayer because they think that's kind of an out. You know, because if you pray that and somebody's like, "Oh, you're not believing God to help me. You're not believing God to heal me or provide for me. He just prayed, 'Your will be done.'" He should be praying, "We're believing you for the job. We're believing you for the healing. He just prayed, 'Your will be done.' Ah, that means he doesn't believe God's going to help me." No, let's get rid of that wrong way of thinking, okay? That's some of that positive confession theology that has crept its way into the church to say that if somebody is praying for you and they're praying, "Oh God, we pray that you touch this brother. We pray that you touch this sister. May your will be done in their life," that all of a sudden they're going off in their mind and thinking, "Oh no, he's given up. He doesn't have faith. I got to go have somebody pray for me who really has faith." Big problem. That's not what's going on with this prayer. You want God's will to be done in every circumstance. You want that. Do you actually think your will is better than God's? Do you think that you're going to go to God and you're going to all of a sudden like show him how you've thought of a better way to do a thing than he has? No, I want you to see this prayer as an active prayer for God to bring about his will, and it is a great and glorious thing. John Whitecross, who I mentioned, I think last week or 2 weeks ago, he tells this story about a woman who was a widow in London. He says, "A Christian widow in London saw with great alarm her only child taken dangerously ill. As the illness increased, she became almost distracted from the dread of losing the child. At length, it became so extremely ill and so convulsed that she kneeled down by the bed, deeply affected, and in prayer said, 'Now, Lord, thy will be done.' From that hour, the child began to recover till health was perfectly restored." So don't just see it as an out. It's not just an out. It is submission, yes, but God may use it as the conduit by which he opens a door, or brings forth a healing, or brings forth supernatural strength, or brings forth a work of salvation. Have that in your mind. May your mind be renewed right now. This story is just one example of a woman who was going through all the motions that she could, and in the moment that she knelt down and she prayed, "Your will be done," God, in his sovereignty, chose at that moment, according to the testimony, from that very hour, to do a work of grace in the life of that child. So I want you to see it not only as a prayer of submission, but I want you to see it as a prayer of action. You are asking for God to bring about his will, and whether or not any of us understand it, or whether or not it is incredibly painful to go through it, we can trust that his will is better than ours. Easier said than done, tremendously easier said than done. But I just like this phrase, and you hear me say it so many times, it's just nevertheless true. It's just true. Now, concerning what we're praying for when we pray, your will be done. We are praying that God would bring about obedience to his will, obedience to his commands. So we're praying for the consummation of history. I'm not going to belabor that because we talked about that last week with the kingdom come. When we pray your will be done, we're praying for the consummation of history where his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. But in the meantime, we're praying that God would bring about obedience to his commands. I want to walk through some scriptures so you just feel this. Feel what you're praying for. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, verse 50, "Whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." You want to know who my brother, sister, and mother is? Whoever does the will of my Father. So when you pray, your will be done, you're in effect praying for conversion. You're in effect praying for people who will become brethren of Jesus. You're praying for conversion when you pray that. When you are praying, may your will be done, you're praying for people to begin to say, like Jesus said in John chapter 4, verse 34, "My food is to do the will of the one who sent me." That's what you're praying for. People who say, "My food is to do the will of the one who sent me." So when you're saying, "Father, may your will be done," you're hoping that that's going to happen in such a way where people in their heart will begin to say, "My food, my sustenance is to do the will of the one who sent me." Jesus said, "I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but to do the will of him who sent me." John 6:38. So when you pray your will be done, you're praying that people would think like Jesus thought. When you pray your will be done, you're praying that people would put a greater premium on God's commands as opposed to the commands of men, which contradict Scripture. You're praying that people would say like John and Peter when they said in Acts 4:19, "We must obey God rather than men." When you pray your will be done, you're praying that God would lead people to worship him in spirit, Philippians chapter 3, verse 3, as opposed to just worshiping him with mere externals. When you pray your will be done, you're praying Psalm 150, verse 6. You're saying, "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." Why? Because that's God's will, that everything that has breath would praise the Lord. So you're praying that. You are praying for people to understand the will of God when you pray that. Colossians chapter 1 verse 9 says, Paul, praying for the church of Colossae, says, "For this reason we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding." So when you pray, "Your will be done," well, you're kind of praying what Paul prayed for the church of Colossae, that people would understand God's will. You're praying Psalm 143, verse 10. You're praying that people would begin to cry this out from their hearts. "Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Your spirit is good. Lead me in the land of uprightness." When you pray your will be done for a Christian brother or sister, maybe you put their name at the end of this prayer, maybe you pray it for people in general, you're praying that they would abstain from sexual immorality. Because 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3 says, "For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from sexual immorality." When you pray for a fellow believer, "Your will be done," you're praying that they would rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and in all things give thanks. "For this is God's will for them and for you who are in Christ Jesus." That's what you're praying for. Just begin to think. Think of the way the Scripture informs this prayer for you. What would God's will being done look like for you as a father? What would it look like for you as a wife? What would it look like for you as a son or daughter? I'll help answer that question for you. Colossians chapter 3, verses 18 through 21. "Wives, submit to your own husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be bitter towards them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing to the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged." That's what you're praying. You're praying these things. That's why it's so important to know the Word of God. Because it's a really weird thing if you're just praying, God, let your will be done. And he's like, oh, I've given you so much of my will to know. And you're like, I don't really know any of it, but I'm just praying your will be done. He's saying, no, that's good. Pray my will be done, but know my will. Know what you're praying for. Why? I think because it's going to fuel your prayer life. Because if you have these promises, if you have these commands, you're going to say, oh, I'm praying this. You have a little list that I just gave you right there of things that you could be praying. Take to the prayer closet. Take on your knees in the bedroom right by the bed and just pray this evening. Take it to the Lord and begin to pray that. Imagine if every person in this room was so led of God the Holy Spirit to say, you know what? I'm putting a greater premium on worshiping God and praying to God than Sunday night football or whatever else is coming my way this evening. I want to pray these things for this local church, yet alone for others, what would happen? Do we think nothing? Do we think nothing? I think honestly, if we took a poll in this room, I think the majority of us would say, no, I think something would happen. Something good? Yes. I think God would answer it. I mean, if we're all praying these kind of things, which we know are God's will, particularly in the lives of his people, we should be so excited to pray these things. And again, I don't mean Sunday night football is evil, by the way, okay? So it's not like, oh man, he's saying, can't ever watch Sunday night football. Not saying that. I'm just saying, it's amazing how many things end up stealing time from the main thing. You can do, you know, have dinner, go for a walk, do whatever you want to do. Just make sure that first things are first. However you schedule that out, I'm not going to be legalistic about that, but just make sure first things are first. All right. Now, if you need a little bit more fuel, I hope this will be it for you. Now, when we're saying, Father, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, notice what we are praying for. I won't spend a long time on the where, because I think you get the where. The where is on earth. But I'm going to spend a little bit more time as we close on the how, as it is in heaven. Well, the first thing we could say about that is we know God sits in the heavens and he does whatever pleases him. So we know that his will is done perfectly in heaven. He's enthroned, he sits in the heavens, he does whatever pleases him. But how is his will done in heaven? It's done perfectly by angels. They don't hesitate to do whatever it is that the Father commands them to do. When you pray, I want your will to be done on earth as it is in heaven, you're in effect praying, Father, I want my obedience and I want my life to be more reflective of the angels' obedience and the way that the angels obey you. Psalm 103, verse 20 says this, "Bless the Lord, you, his angels, who excel in strength, who do his word, heeding the voice of his word." Verse 21, "Bless the Lord, all you, his hosts, you ministers of his, who do his pleasure." They do whatever the Father wants them to do, and they love when the Father asks them to do whatever it is he's asking them to do. They are strong. We see that right there in verse 20 of Psalm 103. "Bless the Lord, you angels who excel in strength." They're so much stronger than us. One of them took out 185,000 Assyrians like that. They're so strong. Yet when God speaks, they love to do his word. They move. They do his pleasure. That's the emphasis here. Who do his word, heeding the voice of his word. You ministers of his who do his pleasure. Now think about the obedience of angels. Think about all the different things that they've been asked to do in Scripture. Start combing your memory banks. And remember, an angel was sent to comfort Hagar, sent on a ministry of comfort. An angel was sent by God to strike down the firstborn of all who were in Egypt that did not have the blood of the Lamb covering the doorposts of their home. It was an angel who struck down 185,000 Assyrians. An angel who came to Zechariah, Elizabeth, Mary, Angel Gabriel. It was an angel and angels who announced the birth of Jesus to the shepherds. It was an angel, angels, who came to minister to Jesus after he was tempted by Satan in the wilderness. It was an angel of the Lord who came to strengthen the Apostle Paul in Acts 27 during that tumultuous time on the ship. It's the angels who will blow the seven trumpets. It's the angels who will pour out the vials of judgment, as it's referred to in the book of Revelation. Their business is to carry out the will of God, whatever it is, small or great. Whether they are going to a person of great prominence or a person of great obscurity, they just do it and they do it with pleasure. So when you pray, I want your will to be done on earth, in this assembly, in this land, as it is in heaven, look at the picture that you're praying. You want swift obedience like the angels. The scripture shows no sign at all of them being complaining or murmuring in the work that they do. If you had to give some description of the angels' obedience, I think these are a few characteristics you could write down. It's swift. They are unconcerned in a good way with the task, whether it's an act of mercy or judgment. It's continual. It's delightful. I used to think, when I first came to Christ, I used to think the obedience of the angels who had to stand before the Lord and just say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, and the whole earth is filled with His glory." I thought they got a bad deal. I was just being honest. I said, "Really?" Because I read in the scripture where it says that they don't stop day and night saying this. So I don't know how much they do it. If they just do that over and over again for all of eternity, I just thought, well, that's a bad deal. I'm happy I'm not them. Let me tell you, they are happy they are them. They're not in the presence of God thinking, this just isn't all it's cracked up to be. Every angel who obeys God is delighted to do so. And I have a guess. I'm going to throw this your way, because I just think it's worth considering. And even if I can't put my gavel down and say, I think this is a clear impetus, I think this text suggests it enough where you'll be edified in my reference of it. Why do the angels obey God so readily? Why do they? That's my question. So I'm going to give my underlying answer, and I'll give a more immediate impetus. My underlying answer is because they are the elect angels. 1 Timothy chapter 5 refers to them as the elect angels. So the reason why they obey God the way they do is because of preserving grace. If you are a Christian, you are saved because of grace that washes away and covers your sins. No angel is going to be reconciled to God through the death of His Son. Jesus did not take on the nature of angels. Jesus took on the nature of man. So those angels that are preserved in heaven are just that, preserved. They were preserved from falling, i.e. elect angels. They were preserved from the fall. So the underlying reason of why they obey God is preserving grace. We are saved by grace and then preserved by grace. They never needed to be saved because they were preserved. So now, what is the immediate impetus for their obedience? Again, I think the simple consideration of this will be edifying to you. I think you'll see in my talking about it, it's edifying to me. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 10, Jesus speaking, and I won't go through the whole context because I want to hone in on one specific thing that He says. He says, "Take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I say to you that in heaven, their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven." That should just make us think. Their angels always see the face of my Father in heaven. Remember when Gabriel was talking to Zechariah, he came with a message. Zechariah struggled to believe him. And Gabriel told him, "I'm Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God." In Revelation chapter 8, verse 2, seven angels stand before God and are given seven trumpets to blow. I think that the immediate impetus for the obedience of the angels is directly connected to the fact that they see the face of God. They see Him. That's where they're coming from. They want to do His will because they know Him more than you and I could even imagine right now. We have His revealed will in the text of Scripture, but we see through a glass darkly. They're not seeing through a glass darkly. Jesus said, "They behold the face of my Father." So these angels, who are models for us of obedience, show us why they're obeying, I think, implicitly in the reality that they're standing in the very presence of God. You better believe when Gabriel was standing in the very presence of God and God tells Gabriel, "Go to Zechariah," you better believe he went, not just because God said go and he was just obeying a command, but because it was God who was giving the command. That's the glorious thing. When we say "Your will be done," we're not just saying it because we know He wants us to say it. We're saying it because we know who is telling telling us to say it. It's him. They see his face. They know what he's like. They know his character, his justice, his love, his attributes, his glory, his grace. They understand and they see. And they're like, I'm going to go do his will. I am his minister, a flame of fire, sent to those who will inherit salvation, sent to do God's will wherever he sends me. And I love to do it because I see him. I know him, therefore I will do his will. I see him. How could I not do his will? I trust him. I trust every word he says. Look at him. If he tells me to go get Assyrians and kill them, I'll do it. If he tells me to strike Herod, I'll do it. Speaking of the angels, they do it. They do what God says. You want me to bring a message to somebody? To Joseph? To Mary? To anybody? What do you want me to do? I'll do it. I trust you. You're amazing. You're God. You're glorious. You're holy. And I think that's going to be part of the immediate impetus for us when we're in heaven. Because in Revelation chapter 22, verses 3 and 4, we read, in the new heavens, in the new Jerusalem, and there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. They shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. I just don't see why there wouldn't be a connection between our service and seeing him. Therefore, in view of seeing him, in view of that day when we will see him, let us pray now, your will be done, your kingdom come. I don't have the privilege of being an angel and standing in the presence of God the same way that Gabriel may have at this very moment that I'm speaking. But I do have the privilege of looking in the text of Scripture and saying, they're obeying this amazing God, and they see him face to face. Therefore, through the lens of faith, and through the lens of the text of Scripture, Father, I want to pray your will would be done. That your will would be done in my life, in my family, in this church, in Staten Island, in this nation, on this planet. So that's part of what you're praying when you say, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. First things first. We sit at his feet, we hear his word, and when we go to him in prayer, we go with another first things first mentality, praying that your name would be hallowed. I'm praying that your kingdom would come. And I'm praying that your will would be done, Father, on earth as it is in heaven. And the last thing I'll say is this. You and I could not even pray this prayer if Jesus did not do the will of his Father. The glorious thing about us being able to pray, your will be done, is because we can only pray it because Jesus said, not my will, but your will be done. If he didn't drink the cup of God's wrath, you have no way to escape the penalty of your sins. But he did. He drank the cup. So that in this very place this morning, whoever would call on the name of the Lord will be saved. For those who have called upon the name of the Lord, for those who have repented, for those who have said, you are Lord, I submit to your Lordship, and I believe the good news of the gospel, you can pray this prayer. Because Jesus did the will of the Father to reconcile you to himself. Thanks be to God. Father, oh, I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your will. And before I say anything else, we do pray that. Lord, we've been saying it this morning. We've been looking at your word, we've been thinking about your word, and we do pray that your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. Father, we do submit to your will. We do pray this prayer as not only an active prayer of what we hope to see you bring about, but as a motion of our heart in which we genuflect before you, as it were. We kneel down and we say, your will, Father, not my will. Your will be done. And Father, for those in this room who would pray that prayer on this day with a little bit more difficulty than prior days, I do pray that you would give them sustaining grace. You're so faithful. You did it for your Son, and he was perfect, but yet you sent ministry his way. So I pray, Father, for those of us in this room who would pray that prayer and are going through seasons of difficulty or waiting or hardship, you know their hearts at this very moment. I pray, Father, that in their hearts would arise a trust, a quiet trust, and that even if it's in their heart, that they would say, even now, Your will be done, Father. I trust you. And I pray that you would provide them strength and endurance and grace and patience in the waiting. But Father, we also pray that prayer in an active way. Bring it about in us, Lord. Help our obedience to be more reflective of the obedience of angels. Idealistically, you know we want to reflect your Son. His obedience is the perfect model of obedience. But we thank you for the examples of the angels in Scripture. And I pray that you would just use all that text, use that truth to just fan the flame of our prayer lives before you, Lord. Oh, may it be. And Father, may the glory of that day and the prospect of seeing you and the prospect of seeing your Son and beholding the Lamb and holding the Lamb. Oh, Lord, may the prospect of that day fuel us to pray with even greater confidence, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We long for that. We long for the consummation of that, and we long for the increase of that in our own lives. And as a local assembly, Father, I close with praying this. As a local assembly, we pray that your will would be done in our church. And we do pray, Father, that your will would be done here as it is in heaven. Bring that about in whatever increased measure that you see fit. You are God, you are Father, and we trust you. We love you. Thank you, Jesus, for doing the will of your Father. Thank you for drinking the cup that we deserve to be drinking forever. Thank you for drinking that cup. I pray that you would help us to bear our little cups of circumstances, even as difficult as they may be. But help us to bear them in view of the fact that you drank the great cup of wrath that we deserve and will never have to drink it because of what you did. Glory to you, Lamb who was slain. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.